crippling some 3 million residents due to a shortage of war. It was just last year that the state of Texas recorded the worst one-year drought in history, according to Dr. John Nelson Gann, the Texas state climatologist and professor of atmospheric science at Texas A&M. Hosanna, Brother Webster gives us four definitions for the word drought. There were two that I would like to draw your attention to today, definition number two and definition number four. Webster defined the drought as a period of dryness, especially proclamated and causing extensive damage to crops or preventing their successful growth. The fourth definition was a prolonged or chaotic shortage, a chronic shortage, or lack of something that is needed or desired. Let me read that one more time. A prolonged or chronic shortage or lack of something that is needed or desired. My brothers and sisters, with this information, I invite your undivided attention to the sermon this morning, How to Overcome a Spiritual Drought. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, you may not need it right now, but at some point in your Christian walk, you're going to need to know how to overcome a spiritual drought. My brothers and my sisters, as we examine verse 3, we will discover four steps that are useful in overcoming a spiritual drought. Listen with me as we hear the prophet, priest, Judge Samuel call Israel to sincerity, separation, and selection in order that they might realize salvation. As we look at a brief history of where Israel was at this time, our Bible scholars will realize that they were in the time of judges. Samuel being the last judge, Israel had determined and decided that they were going to turn from the God that had saved them. They were going to turn from the God that had delivered them over and over again. The same God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that had delivered them out of the hands of the Egyptians. The same one that brought them across the Red Sea. The same one that had fed them manna from on high. The same one that allowed the shoes that they wore for 40 years to last for 40 years. They would turn from that God and serve the gods of the other Amorites and of the other people. It was the same Israel that while they were serving other gods had found themselves oppressed by the Philistines. You do remember the Philistines. They're the ones that later on down the line, the Philistine, the giant of Goliath that David had to slew. It was the Philistines that would oppress Israel for some 20 years. Amen. And we find that Israel had become hard-headed like many Christians today. Embracing the philosophy of inclusion, found themselves embracing the philosophy of tolerance rather than living for God according to what the word says. We find that Israel had made compromises, and Israel decided to move the ark from where it was at. And they found themselves in war against the Philistines. And because they were in war with the Philistines, they took the Ark of the Covenant, which was not God, but represented the presence of God. They moved that ark and they brought it to the battlefield. And when they brought it to the battlefield, they sinned against God. And because they brought it to the battlefield, because they had put their trust in something material, they had trusted the ark to save them and not the God that had delivered them. I don't wonder if anybody today that has put their trust in man, has put their trust in their intellect, has put their trust in their finances rather than to put their trust in the very God that created them. Israel put their trust in this ark. God wanting to teach them a lesson. God allowed the Philistines to capture the ark. And so it was 20 years. from God.
Well,
can you imagine not hearing from God? Can you imagine not experiencing the blessings that God gives us on a daily basis? And so as we look at this, the first thing that Samuel said that Israel needed to do in order to remove themselves of the drought, to overcome the drought that they had found themselves in. Look at verse number 3:8. It says, "Then Samuel spoke to all the house of Israel." In other words, when it says all the house, there was nobody that was not included, saying, "If you return to the Lord with all your hearts." And notice what he said. He did not make it collective, but he said, "If you return with all of your hearts." In other words, all of Israel needs to give their hearts back to God. Hosanna, some of the early scientists and philosophers, to include Aristotle, considered the heart as the seat of thought, as well as emotion and passion, often rejecting the values of the brain. It was the Roman physician Galen that first considered the seat of passion to be the liver, the seat of reason to be the brain, and the heart to be the seat of emotions. It was Strong's that said, that the phrase "all of your heart" means the seat of emotion and passions, or the seat of courage. But I've heard what Strong said and what Galen has said, but I heard Jesus declare that you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all